Hello. Today we are starting partial differentiation, in other words partial derivatives. You come across function of a single variable. A is equal to pi r square. Area of a circle is pi r square. As r varies, area varies. As radius varies, area varies. Area is a function of radius. It's a function of a single variable. Volume 1 by 3 pi r square h. Here r and h are two variables. As r and h varies, volume varies. Now r is one variable, h is a variable. V is a function of two variables. Volume is also a function of length, breadth, height. Length, breadth, height are three variables. Volume is a function of three variables. So we can come across a lot of functions which are functions of several variables. Function of a single variable, two variables, three variables, four variables, five variables, like that. Whenever you have function of more number of variables, we are introducing the concept of partial derivatives. That is, we are differentiating, suppose z is a function of x and y. We are differentiating z partially with respect to x, which means keeping y constant, we are differentiating z with respect to x. Or in other words, dou z by dou x is called the partial derivative of z with respect to x. It is defined as limit delta x tends to 0 of f of x plus delta x comma y minus f of x y by delta x. That means the increment is given only to x, not to y. Y is kept constant. The increment is given to x. You find a ratio between this and limit delta x tends to 0 of that. That gives ultimately dou z by dou x. Similarly, the increment is given to y, not to x. X is kept constant. Find limit delta y tends to 0 of this ratio. That gives dou z by dou y. This can be x. These two are called partial derivatives of first order. These two are called partial derivatives of first order, or first order partial derivatives. Now, this can be extended. Dou square z by dou by dou x of dou z by dou x. Again, dou z by dou x, dou z by dou x is also a function of x and y. Is also a function of x and y. Therefore, we can differentiate this with respect to x or with respect to y. Once you differentiate dou z by dou x with respect to x, we get dou square z by dou x square. Once you differentiate dou z by dou y with respect to x, you get dou square z by dou x dou y. Once you differentiate dou z by dou y with respect to y, you get dou square z by dou y square, etc. These derivatives are called the partial derivatives of second order. Partial derivatives of second order. So, we are defining partial derivatives of first order, partial derivative second order, third order, and so on. So, we can differentiate partial derivatives. For simple example, let us take z is x square plus xy plus y square. X square plus xy plus y square. We can differentiate z partially with respect to x. That means, keeping y constant, we can differentiate with respect to x. Differentiating x square, you get 2x. Xy, differentiating with respect to x, y is kept constant. So, y is kept constant as it is. Differentiate x, we get 1. Differentiating y square, you get 0 because y square is a constant, we are differentiating with respect to x. So, you get ultimately 2x plus y. So, 2x plus y is partial derivative of z with respect to x. In a similar fashion, we can find a partial derivative of z with respect to y. While differentiating z with respect to y, x is kept constant, it is occurring separately, you get 0. We are differentiating with respect to y, keep x as it is, differentiate y with respect to y, we get 1. Differentiating y square, you get 2y. So, you get x plus 2y. So, 2x plus y is partial derivative of z with respect to x, and x plus 2y is a partial derivative of z with respect to y. We can find that dou square z by dou x square. Dou square z by dou x. This is nothing but we are differentiating dou z by dou x. Derivative of dou z by dou x with respect to x partially again, you get only 2. You get only 2. We can also find a dou square z by dou y square. That means find a dou z by dou y, differentiate again with respect to y. We get 2 here. We get 2. Once you differentiate dou z with respect to x, you differentiate this with respect to y, we get dou square z by dou y dou x. Dou y dou x. Differentiating this with respect to y, we get only 1. We get only 1. Similarly, differentiate dou z by dou y with respect to x. We get dou square z by dou x dou y. As we are divided with respect to x, we get 1 because only x is there. Differentiating 2y, we get 0. So therefore, we observe that dou square z by dou x dou y is 1, dou square z by dou y dou x is also 1. Can you ask one question? You can ask one question. Are they equal? No, not necessarily always. So therefore, we are giving conditions. Under what condition dou square z by dou x dou y is equal to dou square z by dou y dou x? What are the relations connecting dou z by dou x, dou z by dou y, etc.? And what's the application of partial derivatives? All these things we are seeing now. One more example we'll take. Z is equal to x square y square. Find all partial derivatives, first order as well as second order. Differentiating z with respect to x, it's a product x square y square. Therefore, we are differentiating with respect to x. Y square is kept constant. Differentiating x square, you get 2x. You get 2xy square. 2xy square is a partial derivative of z with respect to x. Similarly, partial derivative of z with respect to y. That is, x square is kept constant. Y square, differentiating, you get 2y. Again, you get 2yx square. 2yx square. Differentiating dou z by dou x with respect to x again, that is differentiating this with respect to x, we get 2y square. Differentiating this with respect to y, you get dou square z by dou y square, you get 2x square. You get 2x square. Differentiating this with respect to y, you get dou square z by dou y dou x. Dou square z by dou y dou x. Differentiating with respect to y, we get 2y here, 2x is there for 4xy. You get 4xy. Similarly, differentiating z with respect to, that is, differentiating z with respect to y, then with respect to x, you get 4xy. You get 4xy. So, 4xy, 4x, these two are equal. These two are equal. And here this is 2x square, this is 2y square. We have obtained all partial derivatives. These derivatives can be extended also. These derivatives can be extended also. Now, we come across many functions. I'll give one simple application. I'll give one simple application of partial derivatives. Suppose u is a function of x and y. U is a function of x and y, function of two variables. V is another function of two variables. You call this as 2x plus 2y. V is also a function of x and y, but it is 2 times x plus y. We are able to form a relation between u and v. We are able to form a relation between u and v. What's that relation? V is equal to 2 times x plus y, but x plus y happens to be u, therefore v is equal to 2u. This is the relation between v is equal to 2u, relation between v and u. That means the functions are dependent. Dependent in the sense there exists a relation between u and v. Whenever there exists a relation between u and v, if you find a partial derivatives of u with respect to x, partial derivative of u with respect to y, partial derivative of v with respect to x, partial derivative of v with respect to y, v with respect to y. If you find these partial derivatives, that is all first order partial derivatives you have obtained. Dou u by dou x is 1, dou u by dou y is 1, dou v by dou x is 2, dou v by dou y is 2 from this partial derivative. This gives us exactly 0. Exactly 0. If the determinant involving r partial derivatives in order, dou u by dou x, dou u by dou y, dou u by dou x, dou u by dou y, this determinant is equal to 0, this implies u and v are dependent. Dependent in the sense there exists a relation between them. There is a relation between them. This is one simple application. We'll see some more problems in this. For example, u is equal to x plus y plus z. V is equal to x square plus y square plus z square. W is equal to xy plus yz plus zx. Now see, here we are having three functions. Three functions are functions of xy, xy, z. U is a function of xy, z. V is a function of xy, z. W is a function of xy, z. Now, we can, what do you say about these three functions? Are they dependent or not? Are they dependent or not? What you do is, first of all, you find a determinant involving all partial derivatives. Dou u by dou x, dou u by dou y, dou u by dou z. Similarly, dou v by dou x order. Dou v by dou x, dou v by dou y, and dou v by dou z. Dou w by dou x, dou w by dou y, dou w by dou z. We find a determinant involving all partial derivatives. That is determinant. Dou u by dou x is 1, dou u by dou y is 1, dou u by dou z is 1. Dou v by dou x is 2x, dou v by dou y is 2y, dou v by dou z is 2z. Dou w by dou x is y plus z. Dou w by dou y is x plus z. Dou w by dou z is y plus x or x plus y. Now let us expand this determinant and see what happens. We can make use of properties of determinant. 2 is common in the second row. So 2 is taken out. The common factor, if you find in any row or any column, that common factor can be taken out. You get 1, 1, 1. X, y, z. Y plus z. Z plus x. X plus y. We also know that now second column and second row and third row. Third row can be added with second row. You get 1, 1, 1, x, y, z, x plus y plus z, x plus y plus z, x plus y plus z. Adding second row and third row, x plus y plus z, x plus y plus z, x. This x plus y plus z is again common. It's again a common. By taking it out, I am making use of properties to evaluate determinant. Directly, we can make use of Saras rule or any other method which you like. So, expanding, taking x plus y plus z out, which is common to all the elements in the third row. 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, 1, x, y, z. Two rows are identical. Therefore, the value of determinant is 0. That is, determinant involving all partial derivatives become 0. The inference is the three functions are dependent. dependent in the sense this UV, the zero implies UVW are dependent. UVW are dependent. Dependent in the sense you are able to find a relation between U, V and W. Now we go in for a relation. What relation exists between U, V and W? So for that, now, so for these three functions, by looking at the function, we can infer the relation between them. We can infer the relation between them. How U is there, square U, see what happens. Squaring U, U square gives us X plus Y plus Z whole square. That is U square is equal to X square plus Y square plus Z square plus 2 times XY, YZ, ZX. That is U square is equal to X square plus Y square plus Z square is V and XY, YZ, ZX is W, therefore 2W. This is a relation between, U, V, W. If you are able to find a relation between them, immediately we come to a conclusion, the functions are dependent. Once the functions are dependent, the determinant involving all partial derivatives in order, dou u by dou x, dou u by dou y, dou u by dou z, dou u by dou x, dou u by dou y, dou u by dou z, dou w by dou x, dou w by dou y, dou w by dou z is equal to 0. So this is one of the applications of partial derivatives. Now you can ask one question. Suppose if they are not independent, they are not dependent. If they are independent, what happens? Let us take one problem to illustrate that. U is equal to x plus 2y. V is equal to 2x plus y. 2x plus y. We cannot find a relation between u and v. U is not equal to 2v, v is not equal to 2u. U plus V, something like that you are getting, we are not able to find a relation between U and V. In other words, if you find a determinant involving partial derivatives in order, if you find partial derivatives, dou V by dou X, dou V by dou Y, determinant involving partial derivatives, 1, 2, 2, 1, this determinant is not equal to 0 because 1 minus 4 minus 3 not equal to 0. If the determinant involving all partial derivatives is not equal to 0, the inference is U and V are independent. Independent in the sense there exists no relation between them. So you can form a relation if they are dependent. If they are independent, you cannot form a relation. If you are not in a position to form a relation, we come to a conclusion, this U and V are independent. So this is one simple application of partial derivatives. Okay. We are also having another application of partial derivative. That is, when z is a function of x and y, this dz is called a total derivative of z. Which is nothing but dou z by dou x dx plus dou z by dou y dy. Now this dz is given by this formula in terms of partial derivatives. What's the application of this? The application is, if dx is the error in x, and dy is the error in y, once you know dx and dy, we can calculate the error in z. This is called error in z. Now we can find a error in Z approximately, not accurately, approximately, once you have errors in X and Y. Errors in X and Y. Now, this dx is called error in X. This is called error in X. Dx by X is called relative error. Is called relative error. And dx by x into 100 is called percentage error. Is called percentage error. Is called percentage error. So we can find error. Once you know error in x, we can find relative error, percentage error. And error in x is given, error in relative error in x is given, relative error in y is given. We can find relative error in z. All these things are possible. And this is one application. For example, let us take one simple application. You are having a rectangular plot. You are having a rectangular plot measuring 60 by 30. The actual measurement is 60 feet by 1000, 30 feet. The area will be 1800 square feet. The area is 1800 square feet. You are going there to measure. You are going there to measure the plot size, right? Out of curiosity, instead of 60, you are measuring, this is our length, this is our breadth. Now, you are measuring the length as, you are measuring the length as 61 feet. That means, there is an error. You are measuring the length as 61. We are measuring the length as 61. That means error in L is 1. Error in L is 1. You are measuring B properly. So therefore, we are measuring B as 30. There is no error in B. There is no error in B. Now, if there is an error of 1 unit in length, what is the error in the area? What is the error in the area? Suppose we know area is given by length into breadth. Now the new area is 61 into 30. We get 1830 square feet. Now this is the original area. This is the area after making some error in measuring length. Therefore, the error in the area is the difference between this and this, you get 30. You get 30. So, 30 is the error in the area. This is by actual calculation. This is by actual calculation. We can also introduce partial derivatives. We can also introduce partial derivatives to find the error in A. Provided error in L is given, there is no error in B. So for that, we know A is equal to LB. A is equal to LB. DA, this is called a total derivative. This is nothing but dou A by dou L DL plus dou A by dou B DB. This is the formula. This is called a total derivative formula. Total derivative formula. Now we can find. Now see here. Therefore, the error in the area. What is dou A by dou L? Differentiating LB with respect to L, you get B. You get B. DL is the error in the area. Error in the area is 1 unit. Plus, dou A by dou B is L. DB is 0. DB is 0. And the original value of B is 30. Therefore, that is the error. That is the error in the area. That is the error in the area. So, therefore, using partial derivatives, we can find error. Suppose if there is an error in the length as well as breadth, you get some error in the area. Even that can be calculated approximately. This particular chapter is called errors and approximation, because we can find approximate errors for any function of two variables provided errors occur in the corresponding variables x and y. So therefore, making use of the formula, if z is a function of x and y, then dz is called error in z, that is given by the formula dou z by dou x dx plus dou z by dou y dy. So once you know error in x, error in y, error in z can be calculated. If any two are known, the third one can be calculated. This is precisely errors and approximation. It's a very interesting chapter. You can t is equal to 2 pi root l by g. We know this formula, right? And error in l is given, error in g is given. What is error in l? Or in t? Error in t is given, error in g is given. What is error in l? A percentage error in l is given, percentage error in g is given. What is the percentage error in t? All these things can be calculated without any difficulty. Now, in fact, you take the logarithm for the functions and do it. That is more convenient. For example, you take this function itself. T is equal to 2 pi into root of L by G. Using this formula, we are calculating T when L and G are known. Now, the percentage error in L is 1. That is 1% error is made in measuring L. And 1% error in G is made. The 1% error is made in G. What is the percentage error in T? Now, whenever we want percentage error, you take the logarithm. That is convenient for us. Log 2 pi. Half log L minus half log G, taking logarithm, that is L by G power half, half log L, half log G. Since it is denominator, we get minus half log. Taking differential, 1 by T dt, 0, because log 2 pi is a constant. 1 by 2 dl by L, 1 by L dl, minus half of dg by G. Relative error in G, relative error in L, relative error in T. Directly you get a formula. Therefore, to get a percentage error, you multiply by 100. You multiply this by 100. Half of dL by L into 100 minus half of dG by G into 100. This is 1 given, this is 1 given. 1 into half, half. You get half minus half, you get 0. That means what? By making 1% error in L, 1% error in G, and error in T is nullified. Error in T is becoming 0. There is no error in T at all. So therefore, we can adjust the errors in such a way, there will be no error in the ultimate function. Whether it can be period, it can be volume, it can be specific gravity, it can be anything in physics or chemistry or any branch, any variable, any formula you take. Once you make errors in the variables, we can calculate error. So when the error is doubled, when the error is 3 times, 4 times, 5 times, so depending on LNG, errors in LNG, we can easily calculate errors. When the error is doubled, we can easily calculate accordingly. So we can adjust this in such a way, error in T is doubled. Percentage error in double, or relative error is double, ordinary error is double. All these things can be done easily with the help of this. This is our application of partial derivatives in physics, chemistry, botany, zoology, in all branches. Okay. Now coming to partial derivatives, we are having some theorems called Euler's theorem. This Euler's theorem, we are defining Euler's theorem only on homogeneous functions. Z is equal to f of xy is a homogeneous function, is a homogeneous function in x and y. Then, if Z is a homogeneous function x and y, then x into dou Z by dou x plus y into dou Z by dou y is always equal to n times, is a homogeneous function of x and y of degree n. Of degree n. Ultimately, you get x into dou Z by dou x plus y into dou Z by dou y is equal to n times Z, where n stands for a degree. Where n stands for degree, Z is a function. X into dou Z by dou x, y into dou Z by dou y is equal to, always equal to n Z, where n is a degree and Z is the function, provided it is a homogeneous function in x and y of degree n. Now, this theorem is extended. This theorem is extended. Extension says, x square dou square Z by dou x square plus 2xy dou square Z by dou x dou y plus y square dou square Z by dou y square is always equal to n n minus 1 Z, is always equal to n n minus 1 Z if n Z is a homogeneous function in x and y of degree n. Degrees, degree is 3, you get 3 Z here, 3 into 3 minus 1, 2, it is 3 to 6 Z, like that. You can easily fix these things, you can easily fix what is, what will happen if you simplify this, you get n, n minus 1 Z, directly you can say, right. So, therefore, we can apply homogeneous function, we can make use of homogeneous function and verify this results. Let us take one simple example and one more result, you call that as Young's theorem, you call that as Young's theorem. The Young's theorem says, if Z is a homogeneous function of x and y of degree, any degree, dou square Z by dou x dou y is equal to dou square Z by dou y dou x. Dou square Z by dou y dou x. This is called the Young's theorem. Whenever you take any homogeneous function of any degree, we can easily verify the partial derivatives, dou square Z dou x dou y is dou square Z by dou y dou x. You can differentiate with respect to y first, then with respect to x, or with respect to x first, then with respect to y. They are equal, provided Z is a homogeneous function in x and y of any degree. Now, we can easily verify, this Euler's first theorem, second theorem, and this one, Young's theorem. Z is equal to x cubed plus y cubed. Z is equal to x cubed plus y cubed. First of all, you must say it's a homogeneous function. Is a homogeneous function in x and y of degree 3, because each and every term is of degree 3. Each and every term is of degree 3. You find a dou Z by dou x. Dou Z by dou x is 3x square. Dou Z by dou y is 3y square. Dou square Z by dou x square is 6x. Dou square Z by dou y square is equal to 6y. Dou square Z by dou x dou y, that is differentiate this with respect to x, we get 0. That is same as dou square Z by dou y dou x. If you want, you can verify. Differentiate with respect to x, then with respect to y, we got 3x square, the product is 0. So, therefore, we can verify first. Euler's first theorem, x into dou Z by dou x plus y into dou Z by dou y x into dou z by dou x is 3x cube. Y into dou z by dou y is 3y cube. That is 3 times x cubed plus y cubed. That is nothing but 3 times z. 3 is a degree, z is a function. Therefore, you get a 3z. So, Euler's first theorem is verified. Euler's first theorem is verified. For the second theorem, Young's theorem is automatically verified. Here, Young's theorem is verified. So, x square dou square z by dou x square plus 2xy dou square z by dou x dou y plus y square dou square z by dou y square gives, this becomes 0 because dou x dou y is 0, we have one time. X square dou square z by dou x square will be 6x cube. It will be 6x cube. Y square dou square z by dou y square will be 6y. You get y square into this, you get 6y cube. You get 6 times x cube plus y cube. That is nothing but 6 times z. That is n into n is 3, n minus 1 is 2 z. n minus 1 z. So, therefore, once you know, once you fix the degree of homogeneous function, we can say x dou z by dou x, y dou z by dou y is nz, x square dou square z by dou x square, that's 2xy dou square z by dou x dou y, y square dou square z by dou y square is n minus 1 z. This can be extended. This can be extended, x cubed dou cubed z by dou x cubed and so on. That is cubing this, you write a formula like that. And that will be n minus 1, n minus 2 is that. Like it goes. So, this can be extended. This Euler's theorem, first theorem, second theorem, third theorem, etc. All the things can be extended. All the things can be extended. That is very, very interesting. Okay. Now, there are some problems. There are some problems in partial derivatives. Suppose x is equal to r cos theta. It's a very interesting IIT problem. Y is equal to r sin theta. X is equal to r cos theta, y is equal to r sin theta. We can find x square plus y square. That is r square sin square theta, r square cos square theta, you get r square. We can divide one by the other. You get that tan theta is equal to y by x or theta is equal to tan inverse y by x. I'll repeat again. X is r cos theta, x is a function of two variables r and theta. Y is also a function of two variables r and theta. We can find a relation between x, y and r. We can also find a relation between theta, x, y. Theta, x, y. We can get all partial derivatives. We can get all partial derivatives. That is, from 1, we can get 2r dou r by dou x. 2r dou r by dou x is 2x. That is, dou r by dou x is equal to x by r. This is one partial derivative. Similarly, dou r by dou y is equal to y by r, is equal to y by r. That is, we can differentiate r with respect to x, r with respect to y. We can also differentiate theta with respect to x partially, dou theta by dou x. Differentiating tan inverse y by x, 1 by 1 plus y square by x square into different question of y by x with respect to x partially, minus y by x. So, taking LCM, x square gets cancelled, minus y by x square plus y square. This is a partial derivative of theta with respect to. Similarly, we can find a partial derivative of, we can get a partial derivative of theta. We can get a partial derivative of theta with respect to y. 1 by 1 plus y square by x square, differentiating. into derivation of y by x with respect to y, you get 1 by x. Taking LCM, x square, you get x by x square plus y square. X by x square plus y square. Here minus y by x square plus y square. Now, we can easily verify. We can easily verify so many results. Dou theta by dou y, dou theta by dou x, dou r by dou x, dou r by dou y. We can form so many relations. They can ask many relations connecting these four derivatives. This is 1, this is 2, this is 3, this is 4. They can ask many problems connecting these four derivatives. Connecting these four derivatives. That is very, very interesting. You can get a lot of results out of it from these partial derivatives. Very good. I think we can discuss a lot of things about partial derivatives. Let us go to the tracing of curves finally. Tracing of curves in differentiation. Okay, many curves can be traced, and once you trace the curve, we can get lot of inference from that. First of all, let us trace some curves, namely x power 2 by 3 plus y power 2 by 3 is equal to a power 2 by 3. This is a very interesting curve. This curve in particular is called asteroid. This curve is called asteroid. This particular curve is called asteroid. How to trace this curve? What is the shape of the curve? Now, to discuss about a curve in general, you must take parametric equations. That is more convenient. X is equal to a cos cube theta, y is equal to a sin cube theta. These are the parametric equations of this curve. These are the parametric equations of this curve. By understanding the parameters, we can vary the parameter and get all points on the curve. Now, suppose I am giving you some few points, theta, x, y. When theta is 0, cos 0 is 1, you get x is a, sin 0 is 0, you get y is 0. When theta is pi by 4, cos pi by 4 is 1 by root 2, cos 45. Cubing both sides, 1 by root 2, 1 by root 2, 1 by 2 root 2. So, x is a by 2 root 2. Y is also a by 2 root 2. Because cos 45 is 1 by root 2, sin 45 is also 1 by root 2. When x is pi by 2, cos 90 is 0. Therefore, x is 0, sin 90 is 1, you get a, 0 a. When x is pi, cos pi is minus 1, you get x is minus a, sin pi is 0, you get y 0. When x is 3 pi by 2, automatically cos 3 pi by 2, x is 0, y is minus a. And 2 pi ultimately you get x is a, cos 2 pi is same as cos 2 pi is plus 1, you get x is a, y is 0. Now starting from a 0, we are getting a 0 itself. Starting from a 0, understand carefully, it's very interesting because these things are not given in the textbook properly. When starting with a 0, again we are getting, coming with a 0, again with a 0. That means we can trace the curve, we can trace this particular curve called asteroid, particular curve asteroid like this. See the orientation also. Orientation means how theta varies in the anti-clockwise direction. So automatically, when theta is 0, you get a point A0. When theta is 0, you get A0. When theta is pi by 4, a by root 2, a by 2 root 2, a by 2 root 2, you get a point here. You get a point here. You get a point. When theta is pi by 2, so this is the orientation, the point that radius vector goes like this, right? And when theta is pi by 2, x is 0, y is a, you get 0 a. You get this point because it is lying on the y axis because 0 a. When x is pi, you get minus a 0. Minus a 0. When x is 3 pi by 2, 0 minus a. 0 minus a. And again x is 2 pi. That is, it is revolving like this. So therefore x is 2 pi, you get x to a, y is 0. Now it is not a circle. Definitely x power 2 by 3, y power 2 by 3, z power 2 by 3 is not a circle. And this length is shortened. Therefore, you are getting an arc like this. This is a point here. At the same time, x power 2 by 3 plus y power 2 by 3 is equal to a power 2 by 3. We can write this as x square power 1 by 3, y square power 1 by 3 is equal to a power 2 by 3. Power of x is even here. After that, we are raising to the power 1 by 3. We can also write 2 by x power 1 by 3 power 2, y power 1 by 3 power 2. We can write this way, that way. Power of x and y are equal and even. Therefore, the curve is symmetrical about x-axis and y-axis. X-axis and y-axis. So, how do this is obtained? Power of x and y are equal, 2 by 3, 2 by 3. It is also even. Therefore, since it is even and equal, we can simply say the curve is symmetrical about x-axis and y-axis. Since it is symmetrical about x-axis, if you get one arc here, you will be getting one arc just symmetrical arc like this. Since it is symmetrical with respect to y-axis, if you get an arc like this, you will be getting an arc like this. Similarly, you will get an arc like this. So, the curve is symmetrical about x-axis and y-axis. We are getting one arc like this from 0 to here theta is equal to 0, here theta is equal to pi by 2, that is orientation, theta is pi, here theta is 3 pi by 2, here theta is 2 pi again. So, you are getting a beautiful curve. This curve is called asteroid. This curve is symmetrical about x-axis. This curve is symmetrical about y-axis. Right? We can give so many discussion. We can have so many discussion about this. It is enough you know this kind of tracing. And automatically by symmetry, once you know this area, we can easily say the total area is nothing but 4 times this area. Because it is symmetrical with respect to x-axis and y-axis, like circle. So this is tracing of a particular asteroid, namely x power 2 by 3 plus y power 2 by 3 is a power 2 by 3. Now, you must also know the general asteroid. You must know the general asteroid also. That is, x by a power 2 by 3, y by v power 2 by 3 is equal to 1. This is called a general asteroid. It becomes a particular asteroid when v is equal to a. When v is equal to a, you get x power 2 by 3 plus y power 2 by 3 is equal to a power 2 by 3. Therefore, we are getting general asteroid like this. How this asteroid will be? You can easily trace this asteroid like this. This is our A, this is our B. This is our B, this is our A. So, A, B. So, for a general asteroid, A and B are different. For a particular asteroid, A and B are equal. we will be getting exactly this particular shape. You get like this. This is a particular asteroid. A is equal to B. This is here in this case, A is not equal to B. Here, tracing everything remains the same. Here theta is 0, theta pi by 2, theta pi, theta 3 pi by 2, theta 2 pi. By varying that, parametric equations are automatically parametric equations are x is equal to A cos cube theta and y is equal to B sin cube theta. That's all. So according to these parametric equations, you can vary theta and get various values of x and y. By plotting all the points, we are getting a beautiful curve called a general asteroid. General asteroid. Okay. Second, let us take a cycloid. Cycloid tracing is also very important because we are using this cycloid in area, volume, surface area, length of an arc. In applications of integration, we use this. So therefore, this tracing of cycloid is also very important. What is cycloid? First, you take a circle. You take any particular point on this circle. First, let the point P be here. Let the point P be here. You allow this circle to roll on this straight line. When it rolls, you observe where P goes. You observe where P goes. We can easily see the locus of P. As a circle rolls on this line, the path traced by P is called a cycloid. So as it continuously rolls, automatically you are getting a cycloid, a repeated arcs like this. This is called a cycloid. One arc, another arc, like that. This is nothing but one arc of the cycloid. It is enough, you know, one arc of the cycloid. After that, we can get this area, we can rotate that, get the volume, all these things. For that, let us take the equation of the cycloid. These are the parametric equations of a cycloid. These are the parametric equations of a cycloid. How tracing is done? That is very interesting. Theta, x, y. When theta is 0, 0 sin 0, 0, x is 0, cos 0, 1, 1 minus 1, 0, you get 0, 0. You get 0, 0 origin. We can view pi by 2, pi by 4, pi by 6, all the 6 you can give. I am giving pi by 2. Sin 90 is 1. Therefore, you get A pi by 2. Cos 90 is 0, you get only A. Cos 90 is 0, 1 minus 0, you get A. Pi. Sin pi is 0, you get A pi. Cos pi is minus 1, you get 2A. Directly, I am going to 2 pi. In between, you can pass 3 pi by 2, like that. 2 pi. Sin 2 pi. 0, A into 2 pi, get 2 pi A. Cos 2 pi plus 1, y 0. Y 0 here, again y 0. So therefore, we can trace a cycloid like this. We can trace this cycloid like this. When theta 0, x is 0, y is 0, you get this one. When theta is pi by 2, x is a pi by 2, y is a. When theta is pi, x is a pi, y is 2a. When x is 2 pi, it is 2 pi a, y is 0. Here theta is 0, here theta is 2 pi. This distance is 2 pi a. 2 pi a. Or in other words, this coordinate will be 2 pi a 0. 2 pi a 0. Now see here, this is one arc on the side. We can go beyond this. 2 pi, 2 pi to 4 pi another arc, 4 pi to 6 pi another arc, it goes like that. It goes continuously. We are getting a continuous arc. We are getting a continuous arc like this. This is cycloid. This is nothing but a cycloid. So a cycloid can be traced by varying the parameter from the parametric equations get x and y. X is 0, y is 0 here. X is 2 pi, again y is 0. Y is 0 means again it cuts the x axis. You get one arc of the cycloid. It is enough, you know, one arc of the cycloid. Here theta is 0. Here theta is 2 pi. This is one arc of the cycloid. This is one arc of the cycloid. So, therefore, we can trace so many curves. We can trace so many curves like a cycloid, asteroid. So many curves can be traced. Right? We can also trace the curve in polar form. A is equal to A, R is equal to A into 1 plus cos 2 cos theta, R is equal to 2A cos theta. All these things we can trace, this curves in polar form, curves in polar curves. So we can understand curve tracing by tracing so many curves. This is a curve in polar coordinates. This is also a curve in polar coordinates. R is equal to A into 1 minus cos theta. These things can be traced in polar coordinates. We can trace these in polar coordinates. In polar coordinates, we are getting r theta form. This is the radius vector. It is the initial vector. Radius vector is this. Radius vector is this. Given initially, it coincides with this. As theta varies, radius vector goes on increasing or decreasing like that. So we can trace. We can get an arc like this, we can get an arc like this, we can get a chordiad. So many curves can be traced provided you know how to trace this systematically. Theta, varying theta, we can easily vary arc. Ultimately, a curve can be traced. We can trace a circle, parabola, ellipse, hyperbola, all curves can be traced. We can also trace loops. We can also trace loops. So, loops means we get one loop like this, one loop like this. We can trace loops, that is the form 3a y square is equal to x into x minus a whole square, x into x minus a whole square. So it's symmetrical with respect to x axis, power of y is even. So a loop can be traced. And you can also discuss whether you get a further points like this or further points like this. This is possible or this is possible. This is possible, that is possible. That is not possible, this is not possible. Both are not possible, one is possible, one is not. All these things we can discuss by tracing. So, we'll discuss this afterwards. So, thank you. We'll stop with this. Next class, we'll discuss some other things.